Everybody? Yes. My name is Tobias Buchborn, as announced. I'm a psychologist, a German psychologist, and I do neuropharmacological research on serotonergic hallucinogens. Today, I would like to talk with you about some of the results I made throughout my PhD project. In this project, I investigated the phenomenon of tolerance in the context of serotonergic hallucinogens. Before we come to talk about the results and the interpretation of these, I would like to give a short introduction to the field. Serotonergic hallucinogens can broadly be divided or chemically divided into indole and phenylacrylamines. The former subsume substances such as LSD, psilocybin, and DMT, and the latter substances such as mescaline, DOB, DOI, and so forth. What they all have in common is that they activate the serotonin 2A receptor. And by doing so, they are thought to induce alterations of consciousness. When talking about the conscious effects of these substances, it's best to differentiate between the different dimensions of the psyche. For example, perception. In terms of perception, they are known to rather induce illusions and pseudo-hallucinations, so real hallucinations rather do not occur, although, of course, this depends a little bit on the dosage and whether you have your eyes closed or not. In terms of affection, they induce an excitation, which means, or I like this word a lot in this context, because altos, the Latin word means high and low, and hallucinogens actually can boost both the positive and the negative emotions. The most important effect probably of these drugs is their effect on the ego. They are thought to increase the permeability of the ego, which allows the ego to more readily interact with the autonomic instances within the psyche. Pharmacologically and psychologically, serotonergic hallucinogens need to be differentiated from other hallucinogens and hallucinogen-like drugs, such as dissociatives, delirants, entactogens, and so forth. When you apply LSD and DMT, as I just said, you have a psychedelic effect. And now we have to ask ourselves, what is tolerance? When you repeatedly apply LSD, what you see that although you take the same dosage, the effects of the drug decrease. And for LSD, it has been described that by the day 4 already, the effects of the drug are almost completely gone. So this phenomenon is called tolerance. This is nothing specific to hallucinogens, actually known for a lot of other drugs as well. But for hallucinogens, it's very quickly. This tolerance phenomenon has been described for LSD and for other serotonergic hallucinogens, but there's one exception to the rule, which is DMT. When you apply DMT repeatedly, there is no decrease in effect, so there is no tolerance. And the project here, what I would like to present is, why is it, that was our question, why is it that LSD induces tolerance, whereas DMT does not? This is the question. Before we can answer this question, we have to understand the mechanisms of tolerance. There are three main mechanisms of tolerance. There's pharmacokinetic tolerance, which means that when you repeatedly apply a drug, the body finds a way to increase the metabolism of the drug. And as a consequence, the concentration which reaches the brain is decreased. This is pharmacokinetic tolerance. Then there's pharmacodynamic tolerance, which means that the body finds a way to get rid of the target of the drug, so the serotonin 2A receptor in the context of hallucinogens, or the interaction with the G protein and so forth. The third mechanism of tolerance is behavioral tolerance, which means that you find a behavior way of compensating for the drug effect. So this is something psychological. For example, if you take chronically alcohol, then you can practice to speak clearly because alcohol makes you speak slowish, and this practicing leads to a form of tolerance which is called behavioral tolerance. Genau, in the context of hallucinogens, it is thought that pharmacodynamics are the most important mechanism. So it's not pharmacokinetics, and it's rather not behavior, it is rather pharmacodynamics. And so our simple hypothesis about this difference between LSD and DMT is, if LSD and DMT both induce psychedelia by activation of serotonin 2A receptor, then we assume the fact that LSD induces tolerance has something to do with the fact that the body gets rid of the serotonin 2A receptor or decreases the responsiveness of this receptor. And for DMT, there is no such getting rid action. So this is the hypothesis, and we want to test this hypothesis. This is how we did it. We investigated the serotonin 2A regulation by LSD and by DMT. We did it on different levels in terms of animal behavior, of course, in terms of serotonin 2A desensitization, internalization, PAD activation, and mRNA regulation. Today, however, we will only focus on the first two aspects. Yeah, if you want to measure psychedelia in animals, how can we do this? Actually, we cannot do it because we cannot ask the animals, do you have psychedelia? So we have to approach psychedelia in a different way. And the most important criteria for animal models is that they are mediated, whatever hallucinogens induce the behavior you're looking at must be mediated by the serotonin 2A receptor. Otherwise, it is not a good model because psychedelia is also mediated by this receptor. There are three main animal models for serotonin 2A activation. One is the drug discrimination paradigm, one is hypothermia, one is shaking behavior. We now had to make a decision which one to choose for our investigation. We could not use the discrimination paradigm because you have to teach the animal to discriminate between the drug and saline. And this needs months of drug application before you can even start with the tolerance experiment. So there's a confounding between the training and the tolerance experiment. So we could not use this. We tried shaking behavior, but unfortunately, so this is wet dog shakes and head twitch responses. Unfortunately, DMT does not induce shaking behavior in rats because of the serotonin syndrome. So it has an unfortunate receptor profile, so cannot really detect shaking behavior in rats. So the last opportunity we had was hypothermia. Problem with hypothermia is that the research so far has only been done in rabbits, so there was a little uncertainty whether we could also find it in rats, but we gave it a try. So this is what we did. We wanted to see, is there tolerance in terms of hypothermia for LSD and for DMT? We used a serotonin 2A specific dose of LSD, of DMT, and of DOB, but what we had to realize that neither LSD nor DMT induces hypothermia. Only DOB induces a trend for hypothermia. So this was a drawback because we wanted to use this model. So we looked into the literature and thought tried to find a way to get rid of this problem. And what we did is actually we increased the ambient temperature. When you increase the ambient temperature, then hallucinogens induce hypothermia. Here you can see LSD, which is the violet one, and the brown one being DMT. DMT is a little bit more steeper in terms of temperature increase, but they induce hypothermia to a similar extent. Now that we have this effect, this is very nice, we next have to ask ourselves, is this hypothermia really mediated by the serotonin 2A receptor? Because otherwise it is not a good model for psychedelia. So how can we test this? The first, what we did is we used a relatively selective serotonin 2 agonist. It does not really differentiate the different subtypes, but it is fairly selective for the family, which is DOB. And when you apply DOB, you also have hypothermia. This shows that the activation of the serotonin 2 family is sufficient for hypothermia to occur. So this is number one evidence that serotonin 2 receptors are important. The next thing we tested, of course, were antagonists. We used ketanserin and MDL-100-907. Ketanserin blocks serotonin 2A and serotonin 2C receptors, and MDL-107 is more specific for the serotonin 2A receptor. What you can see is that both significantly block the effect of LSD, with the serotonin 2A specific agent being even more efficient. Of course, we also tried it for DMT, but the results are similar. So what we can say, we can use this model. Hypothermia seems to be a good model of psychedelia because you can block it by serotonin 2A antagonists. So now that we know this, we next want to investigate the phenomenon of tolerance. So what we did is we applied DMT and LSD for 4 days, twice a day, and measured hypothermia on the first and on the last day. And what you can see is that for LSD, when you repeatedly apply LSD, the hypothermia significantly decreases, which means tolerance occurs. So similar as in a human situation, tolerance occurs. For DMT, on the other hand, there is no tolerance. So this is again similar as with the human situation. There was a little problem, however, because we also found a significant decrease for the control group. This, of course, is not tolerance, because you cannot become tolerant to saline. This has rather something to do with physiological habituation. And that is why we have to cleanse this difference out of these differences. When doing so, you still have a significant tolerance for LSD and for DMT. There even seems to be a little sensitization. I'm sorry. So this mirrors the human situation. This is very interesting. What we also investigated is hypersalivation. This is a phenomenon which is associated with hyperthermia. Hypersalivation is something like sweating in rodents. They produce massive saliva and spread it into their fur. And this is something that cools the body down. And here you see the similar pattern as with hyperthermia itself. You have tolerance for LSD, but not for DMT. Now that we have this difference, the same difference we have in humans in terms of physiology, the next thing we wanted to know is whether we also find this difference in terms of neurochemistry. So what we did is the gamma-GTPase binding assay. I would like to explain to you what it is. We have the brains of the animals. We dissect the membrane fraction of these brains, of these different brain areas, and then the serotonin to A receptor can be found within these membrane fractions. And then we apply selective serotonin 2 agonist. We use DOB here. When doing so, the signaling cascade is initiated, which is specific for the serotonin to A receptor. Before this signaling cascade comes to pass, however, energy is needed. And for this energy to be conferred, GTP is needed. So GTP displaces GDP at the G protein, and this transfers energy to the whole process. This is a very good thing because we can measure it. How can we measure it? By pre-labeling the membranes with radioactively labeled gamma-GTPs. This gamma-GTPs replaces the endogenous GTP, and then at the end you can measure the radioactivity. When there's high radioactivity, you have a good receptor which is functional and active. If you have low radioactivity, then the receptor is not active anymore. Okay, this is the assay we perform with the brains of the tolerant and not tolerant animals. And we did it in the frontal cortex because the frontal cortex is important for the psychedelic effect. We did it in the hypothalamus and in the brainstem because these areas are involved in temperature regulation. When doing so, we found that after repeated application of DMT, there is no change in the signaling capacity of the serotonin 2 receptor, but after LSD, there's a significant decrease. So the LSD-tolerant animals show a serotonin 2 functioning that is decreased, so it's a hypofunction, whereas for DMT, you don't find such an effect. We also measured glutamate because serotonin 2A receptors in the frontal cortex release glutamate, and it thought that this glutamate interaction with the receptor is then at the end important for the psychedelic effect to occur. When doing so, we find no difference for LSD, but a trend for DMT, which is very interesting because this implies a little bit that the glutamatergic system tries to compensate for the lack of serotonin to AD sensitization. We have similar results in the context of shaking behavior, a paper we published before. So there seems to be a complementarity between the serotonin to A receptors and the glutamatergic system. Yes, we also investigated it in the brainstem, as I said before. Here you have actually a similar pattern. You have no significant decrease for DMT, but a strong trend for decrease for LSD. The fact that it doesn't become significant here might have something to do with the fact that the serotonin receptor is less expressed in the brainstem than in the frontal cortex, and the assay might not be sensitive enough to detect the signaling here. We also tested it in the hypothalamus, but surprisingly, there was no change. This is surprising because we have change in terms of temperature regulation, but we don't find this change in terms of hypothalamus. This is a little paradox. Anyhow, we are at the end already. I hope I'm not too quick. I would like to summarize the results. When you apply LSD or DMT at increased ambient temperature, then you induce hypothermia. This hypothermia is or when you repeatedly apply LSD, there is tolerance to hypothermia, but when you repeatedly apply DMT, there is no tolerance to hypothermia. So this is what we showed. We also showed that the hypothermia is mediated by the serotonin 2A receptor by the fact that DOB mimics it, and by the fact that serotonin 2A antagonists block it. So this is all in parallel to the human situation. We know that DMT, LSD induces psychedelia, and that with repeated application it is decreased, and for DMT it is not, but both are thought to be mediated by the serotonin 2A receptor, so the animal situation perfectly mirrors the human situation. Also, apart from this physiological differential tolerance development, we also found that LSD, the repeated application of LSD, leads to an uncoupling of the serotonin 2A receptor from the G protein. We showed this by the gamma GTPS binding assay in the frontal cortex, but for DMT, we didn't find such an effect. So all of this put together, what does it imply? The taking home message of this talk is, if somebody asks you, why is it that DMT doesn't induce tolerance but LSD does, then you can refer to my talk today and say, I've been to the ECPR and I know it, the evidence imply that LSD, both on a physiological and on the frontal cortical level, desensitizes serotonin 2A receptors, but DMT does not. That's it. Thank you very much.
Do you think that the difference between the desensitization is in part because the effects of DMT are more acute and its metabolism is much more quickly than where LSD stage, the plasma levels for LSD stay much more prevalent, and its effects on the 2A receptors are more prolonged, and therefore the decoupling is more.
So you think the lag of tolerance has something to do with the fact that DMT acts shorter than LSD? Yes. This is what you imply. But there is one study with ayahuasca, performed with ayahuasca. So they applied ayahuasca repeatedly and found that there was no tolerance either. And in ayahuasca, the degradation of DMT is blocked. So you have actually an effect of 6 hours. And this is, of course, LSD acts a little longer, 8 to 10 hours. But 6 hours is still sufficient time to if DMT was able to downregulate the receptor.
So could that also be in the length that, like the amount of time that DMT binds to the 2A receptor, or
I think there are no studies on it. Okay. Possibly, yeah. Actually, there are two interpretations. Why is it that the one desensitizes and the other does not? If DMT binds to the serotonin 2A receptor, a certain conformational change occurs. If LSD binds to the serotonin 2A receptor, another conformational change occurs. And depending on the conformation that is induced, different sets of proteins are recruited. So this is one factor which could contribute to the desensitization, and another factor could be that the one or the other dissociates more quickly from the reset board, but to my knowledge, there's no data about this. But it is possible.
Thank you. I remember reading some time ago, I can't remember which paper, unfortunately, that serotonin 2A receptors tend to form heterodimers with glutamatergic receptors when exposed to, I think it was LSD. Do you think this could have any connection with the change in the glutamatergic system that you mentioned?
Yeah, I do think so. Actually, we published a paper a few months ago, and in this paper we investigated tolerance to LSD and DOB-induced shaking behavior, and we found that the repeated application of DOB leads to a desensitization and a reduction of serotonin 2A binding sites. For LSD, it was not as clear, but LSD reduced glutamate binding sites, so again, there was the complementarity, and we also investigated mGlu2/3 receptors, and we found that the one that both, let me think, what was it? Both induce a desensitization of it. I think that was it. And we also did a correlation investigation, but the correlation was different for the one that was a negative one. So the interpretation is a little difficult. But it is possible that it plays a role. I think so. Okay.
Thanks very much.
So this is a bit anecdotal, maybe, but from people who use DMT, I've heard that it takes a few hours. There is a tolerance factor, but just sort of within a day after the DMT effect has gone, and they try to use it like an hour or two later, they do have a tolerance. Do you know anything about that? Or?
So you ask, there is anecdotal report. I think it was described in this encyclopedia, in some encyclopedia. That, is that what you're referring to, that when you take LSD, DMT now and you take it again in 20 minutes, there's no effect, but when you repeat it after 20 minutes, then you have the effect?
Yeah, then if you take it sort of after an hour or...
Okay, this is actually a different form of tolerance. So this is tachyphylaxis. This is called tachyphylaxis. If you apply a certain substance within 24 hours and then there is tolerance, this is tachyphylaxis. But the mechanisms might be different. So you cannot discuss this on the same sheet. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you what the reason is for this phenomenon.
Okay.
Perhaps it has something to do that, with the fact that the receptors are occupied and you cannot get it any higher. But it could also be that at this short time period, some sort of regulation occurs. Because I have to stress that I showed only investigations for desensitization, but other components of the regulation process are also involved. So receptor serotonin 2A internalization, recruitment of certain proteins, phosphorylation processes, mRNA regulation, down regulation. So all of these processes actually have to be looked at to find a more complete picture and perhaps to answer this paradox about tachyphylaxis.
One last question. The best theory that I've ever read about DMT tolerance is from, I think it's Jonathan Trout's book, Some Simple Tryptamines, and his hypothesis was that it was actually, the tolerance was caused by combusting the material and that having a very caustic effect on the lung tissue, and that your violi that contract, and then they can no longer accept that substance for a time until that tissue heals. So if you're vaporizing that DMT at like the appropriate temperature, that doesn't occur. So that's yeah.
I didn't know this. Interesting. Thank you. That's it. Thank you. Yeah.